told me all I need to know. I'm done with doubt. 'Cause even if I sink in fear, you'll lift me up. So silence every storm in me, and I'll be safe. As faith comes rising up in me above the waves.
Whether I'm on the shore or sea, you've already proved your love for me. If I find myself back in the storm, I'm gonna trust you, Lord, like I'm on the shore.
But I feel the rain falling, I walk on these waters, leaning on your promise.
You are God, you are good. When I feel the rain falling, I walk on these waters, leaning on your promise. You are God, you are good. Whether I'm on the shore or sea, you've already proved your love for me. If I find myself back in the storm, I'm gonna trust you, Lord,
like I'm on.
Their sins just disappear. For anyone who's ever felt the hand of heaven reach down through their fears and dry their tears. For any life once empty that now finds itself alive and full of songs, victory songs, then you'll understand the reason. For the way the saints of God, they carry on.
So if I shout, no, I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. If I run, no, I'm running from a past that's been redeemed. To the world, if I look crazy, there's just no telling what you're gonna do. In that moment, Jesus gets a hold of you.
Them moving on through troubled days. For anyone who knows they've got a future and a hope beyond the grave.
Lord's house tonight, ain't it? Amen. Good to see everybody tonight. Welcome to Wednesday night service. We're glad you're here. A couple quick announcements. Pastor is out of town for a little while. Y'all keep him and his family in your prayers. Pastor Tyler's with him. Y'all continue to pray for them. Also, preschool graduation is coming up. That is on May 23rd. I believe that is that next Thursday is what I believe that is? Yes? Okay, next Thursday, preschool graduation, May 23rd at 6 p.m. Listen, I understand people got to work. I get it. You might not have a kid in the graduation. You might not know anybody in the graduation. However, it looks wonderful for our church to be supportive of everything that goes on at this place. It's an absolutely wonderful thing. It's a great thing. It would be much appreciated. I know Miss Kristen would appreciate it. Brother Trevor would appreciate it. All the staff, all the teachers, including the parents, they would really appreciate it. If you can make it, we ask that you would. I understand, like we said, it. People got to work. People got things to do. But if you got nothing going on and you can, it would be wonderful to be here to support them, if nothing else, to support Miss Kristen and all that she's done this year as well and all the teachers and staff of the preschool. Amen? Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Also, don't forget, Sunday the 26th is Remembrance Sunday. That is for Memorial Day. This would be a wonderful service if you know of anyone that has lost someone due to combat, due to military reasons, or maybe you served in the military and you have friends and you all lost someone together. This would be a wonderful Sunday to invite them to come to church. Some people won't embark the doors of a church for nothing unless there's a special day. And this would be a wonderful opportunity for you to invite someone that day. Please keep that in mind. Remembrance Sunday for Memorial Day. We're going to honor our fallen soldiers on that day. So if you know of anyone that their lives were affected by that, that would be a wonderful Sunday to invite them to be with you. Friends, family, your neighbor, the guy at Walmart that you don't even know, just bring them. It'd be a wonderful Sunday. Keep that in mind. Also, don't forget, Awana graduation, that is on May 29th. May 29th is the Awana graduation. That'll be taking place, if I remember right, that'll be taking place inside of the service. That'll be a big deal. We always try to make a really big deal out of that. So don't forget that. That'll be at 6:30, our normal service time, May 29th, Awana graduation awards night. We ask that, don't get the idea that because we're doing that, we're not having church. We are having church. That is going to be going on during church. So church is not canceled. Church is not postponed. That is church that night. And we ask everybody to be here, support the Awana group, support the Awana teachers, support the children in Awana. They're learning about the Lord. They're learning about the Bible. They're learning about Jesus. And the last thing we want them to learn is that church is only important sometimes. Somebody say amen right there. So remember, church is not canceled. We are just having an Awana Awards night for their graduation. We ask that we all would be here excited, ready to clap, ready to cheer, and be an encouragement to not only these children, but also to their families. Amen. Let's go ahead and open up in a word of prayer, and then we'll get into the service. Dear Heavenly Father, we come unto you, Lord. God, I thank you for this opportunity. Lord, I thank you for this time that you've given us. Lord, you've been so good to each and every one of us, Lord. And God, if we took time to thank you for everything you've done, we would run out of time, Lord. There wouldn't be enough time in our lives to praise you for all the goodness that you've shown us. Lord, we thank you for this church. We thank you for the people in this church. Lord, we understand that it is just a Wednesday night. But, Lord, we don't want to take a Wednesday night and diminish the idea that God could do something tonight. I believe that we serve the same God on Wednesdays that we do on Sunday mornings. And I'm asking you, Jesus, that tonight you would do something special in our hearts. Lord, I ask you to do something special during our prayer time together. Lord, do something special during the preaching tonight. I ask you, Lord, that you would do something great. You would do something mighty and wonderful. Lord, I ask you to do something on a Wednesday night that is so abnormal that we would have to leave saying there's no way that was anything other than the Spirit of the Lord. Father, we praise you for all that you've done and all that you're going to continue to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's take up some prayer requests tonight. Just a few I got right here, and then we'll open the floor. Continue to remember our pastor and his family as they're traveling. Continue to pray for Miss Rhonda as she continues going through what she's dealing with. Miss Donna Faye and her family, remember her. Does anybody have an update on how she's doing? No? Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, that was good, but okay. So just, all right, just remember Miss Donna and her family. Continue to pray for Israel, as they're still facing what they're facing right now with Hamas and all that's going on, Islam. Just pray for them. Pray for the whole nation of Israel. We know that the Lord blesses Israel, but I believe the Lord also said he will bless them that bless them. So let's pray for Israel. Pray for their soldiers. Pray for the citizens there. Also, something we really need to pray about is the 2024 election. That's not far away. I know that it's really easy to get complacent when it comes to really, really big things that we have to trust the entire nation to make right decisions on. And it's really easy to say that prayer won't affect it any. And I just completely don't agree with that. I believe that all things can be conquered through prayer through the Lord. We should pray about this. The Bible tells us to pray for our leaders. We should be praying for the president we have right now. And no, I'm not just talking about to drop over dead. We should be praying for him. We should pray for his salvation. We should pray for his soul. We should pray for his decisions. And we have a very important election year coming up this year in November. And I believe that as God's people, if we're ever going to see a change, the change has to start with our mindset. And we need to start praying for that now. We need to pray. Listen, we all got a favorite candidate, but I'm not praying that my favorite candidate wins. I'm praying that the man that God has ordained for this time in the humanity right now is the guy that gets into office. That's who we need in office, not my favorite candidate, not the guy I want to win, and I'm not just praying that the people I dislike don't win. I'm praying, God, whatever your will is. Maybe the Lord's ready to wrap this thing up and the worst possible candidate goes in, and if that's God's will, let God's will be done. And if the Lord says, I want America to thrive one more time and he wants to put somebody else in, then let the Lord's will be done. But we need to pray that God's will and God's man makes it into that office and into that position. Someone say amen right there. Amen. Let's take up some prayer requests. Anybody tonight? Yes, ma'am.
Pray for my sister as she continues to go through treatment at rehab. She's trying to call home, but we don't answer her calls because we just don't think she's quite ready to talk to us. So, and they extended her stay, so just pray that, God will intervene in her life.
It's Tiffany's sister. That's Michelle, right? Yeah, Michelle. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
I'd like for us to really pray for Mike Powers tonight. He went to the eye doctor Monday, and he's losing his eyesight. And he's got glaucoma, and it's severe, and it's stage 5. And so they're trying to do what they can to save his sight. But today he was totally blind. And they said he could have worse days before it starts getting better with medication. But he's very discouraged. Just pray for him that God will touch his eyes and give him his eyesight back. And we need to remember Miss Beatrice. She's had 2 family members in her family pass away in the last couple of days. So we need to pray for them. And also Miss Rachel Kimbrell, one of our seniors that's in the hospital. She failed, but they did transfer her to rehab. But we just need to continue to pray for her.
Brother Mike, with his eyesight, his health, his eyesight's not doing good. Miss Beatrice has had some loss in her family, and Miss Rachel Kimbrell, some of you may not know her, but she's been a member here for a very, very long time. Her health has caused her to be a shut-in. She doesn't get to come physically with us anymore, but she's not doing well. She failed, so remember her and her health tonight. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
I want to pray for the Tillman family. They lost their son.
You said the Tillman family?
Yes.
Amen. Anybody else? Miss Aunt Brenda, did I see your hand?
You did, and you know what? It just slipped my mind.
Okay.
Thank you, all.
But ain't you glad the Lord knows about it?
Yeah, I am.
Pray for Aunt Brenda's forgotten prayer request. Amen. If she remembers now, and if somebody in here, they're going to say Aunt Brenda forgot about her. So, no, I'm just playing.
Yes, sir.
Hey, I got a couple people from Tyler and Heather.
Heather Staten and their new baby. Staten family and their new baby, Miss Jane Shelley and her health, and also continue to remember Dad, Brother James, and his health. Amen. Anybody?
Yes, ma'am. We need to continue to pray for Judy and her brother. He's deteriorating.
Pray for Miss Judy. She's in Maine now, seeing her brother. Her brother's health is not doing well at all. He's in a very, very bad place with his health. Continue to pray for her as she's with him and him as well. Yes, ma'am.
Just continue to pray that we get the teachers needed for the preschool. And pray for me because I have fallen in love.
for the preschool needs. Pray that these children, the ones that are graduating, that we may never see again, that this is something that sticks with them. It's not something that slips from one ear and out the other. The world is cruel. It's a very cruel place, and it's a very influential place. And I believe what we do here is hyper important for that reason. Very important that these children have a foundation to fall back on one day. Amen. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
My little brother, Austin.
Austin. Yes, ma'am.
There
you go.
Sister Judy, Hildary, that works at Walmart.
Mm-hmm.
Her brother passed away Monday morning. It's the one that lived with her and her sister. And I talked to her today, and she's asked to be remembered.
Thank you. It's Judy Hildary, also her brother.
Remember her. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Ashlyn and her health. Pray the doctors figure out exactly what they need to. Amen. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Katie's mom, her biological mother, and continue to pray for Stephen. Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
She's not in here, but can we pray for Shay's parents that God's will just be done in their lives?
Amen.
And pray for Trevor's dad.
Yeah. And for Billy.
Billy Jacobson. Amen. Let's all gather around the altar together. We're going to pray together. Pray over these needs. Pray for them out loud. The Bible tells us the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And I believe with all my heart that if we pray these prayers and we mean these prayers and we expect God to do great things, I believe God can do great things. I don't think he needs our help to do great things, but I believe he likes it when we come to him brokenhearted and ready, expecting to see him do something great. So let's pray over these requests tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, I come unto you, Lord God. I thank you for this time and this opportunity. Lord God, I ask you, Father, that you would be with us here tonight at Greater Life. Lord, I ask you, Father, that you would bless the preacher tonight. Lord, that you would use him in a mighty and a powerful way. Lord God, I ask you to take him and use him tonight. Father, I ask you to bless our pastor and his family as they're traveling, Lord God, this week and as they go through their travels. Lord, I ask you to give them traveling mercy, traveling grace. Lord, keep them safe, Lord, as they're at their destination and on their way home as well. Lord, I ask you, Father, you would keep them, give them the rest and relaxation they need. Lord, I ask you to be with Miss Rhonda and her health. Lord God, I ask you to continue to keep your hand on her life and in her situation. Lord, I ask you, God, to touch Miss Donna and her family. Lord, I ask you, Father, to please touch her health and touch her family in a spiritual way. Lord, I ask you, God, that you would do something great in that situation. Lord, I ask you, Father, that you would bless the nation of Israel. Lord, I ask you, God, that you would do something mighty. You would do something wonderful for your people. Lord, God, we know that you bless your people. We know that you look after your people. But, Lord, I'm asking you, Jesus, on my behalf as well. Lord, God, would you look over the nation of Israel? Lord, God, keep your people safe. Give your people victory, Lord. We ask you, Father, to bless that nation. Lord, God, we pray over the upcoming election this year. Lord God, we ask you, Father, that your will would be done in this time. Lord, I ask you, God, that you would have your will and way. Lord, that you would do something mighty. You would do something powerful and wonderful. Lord God, I would love to see certain people go into that office. I would love to see America take a turn for the better. Lord, I would love to see things change in this country. But Lord, most importantly, what I want, Lord, is I want your will to be done. Lord God, what I want, what I need, and what I think is best for this place has got nothing to do with what the will of God is. And I'm asking you, Father, that you would let your will be done in this country. Lord God, I ask you to touch Billy Jacobson. Lord, I ask you, Father, that you would convict his heart. Lord God, that you would get on him. Father, I ask you to use Trevor and, Lord, use Miss Tammy to get to him. Lord, I ask you, Father, that you would lay in him. Lord, lay on his life. Lord, lay in his heart. Lord, I ask you to get in his mind. Lord, keep on it every day, every night. Lord, wreck his sleep, wreck his appetite. Lord, I ask you, Father, that you would stay on that man. Lord, I pray the same over Stephen McCraven. Lord God, I ask you, Father, that you would do something in his life. Lord, I ask you that you would do something in his mind, Lord, in his heart. Lord, I ask you, Father, to help that man. Lord God, I ask you to please be with Michelle. Lord God, Miss Tiffany's sister. Lord, you know the things that she's dealing with right now. You know what's going on in rehab right now. You know the issues and the struggles that she's dealing with as we pray this very minute. I ask you, Father, to give her relief of her addictions. I ask you, Father, to give her relief of her pain. I ask you, Father, to relieve her in her emotions and her body physically. And most of all, I ask you, Jesus, that you would reach down and touch her heart. Lord, I ask you to be with Brother Mike Bowers tonight, Lord, as he's dealing with some health issues in his eyesight. I ask you, God, to please bless him and help him. Lord, Miss Beatrice, Father, as she's dealing with the loss of some family members, I ask you to give her comfort during this time. Lord, I ask you, Lord, to help Miss Rachel Kimball and her health, Lord, as she fail. God, I ask you, Father, to please touch her feeble body and help her, Lord, back to good health. Lord, I ask you to be with the Tillman family as they're dealing with loss at this time. Lord, God, bless them and help them. Give them comfort during this trying time. I ask you, Jesus, to bless Tyler and Heather Staten, Lord God, and their precious little girl, Lord, the answered prayer that we prayed for just a little over a year ago that we began to beg you for and plead with you for at 9 o'clock prayer meeting. And, Lord, we watched you answer a mighty prayer and do a mighty work in their lives. And I'm asking you, Jesus, that you would get up in their lives and you would get up in that little girl's life and you would let this be, Lord, a token to them to see the faithfulness of God. I'm asking you, Father, you'd be with Miss Jane Shelley and her health issues that she's dealing with right now. I ask you, God, to please bless my dad. Lord, I thank you for the mighty work that you've done in his body, Lord, the things that you've done in healing him. I ask you, Father, to please continue to help him in his health. Lord, Miss Judy Butler, as she's in Maine right now with her brother, I ask you, Father, to give her, Lord, give her some comfort during this trying time. Give her brother some comfort during this trying time. Lord, I ask you that you would bless both of them. Help them, Lord God, during this tough season. I ask you, Father, that you would please touch the preschool, Lord, and its needs. You see the needs that it has. Lord, we need people that'll work. We need people that'll do this job. Lord, we need people that'll invest in these children. I'm asking you, Lord God, that you would send the right people, that you would let your will be done. I ask you, Father, as the kids are embarking upon graduation from this preschool and they'll be turned out into the world, Lord God, they'll begin to go to maybe secular schools and they'll grow up into secular high schools and secular colleges, work in secular jobs. I'm asking you, Father, that the spiritual foundation that was laid for them here will be something that sticks with them forever. I'm asking you, God, tonight to help Austin, Lord, wherever he's at. I ask you, Father, to get a hold of that young man. Miss Judy Hildreth, Lord, as she's dealing with loss right now, I ask you to give her comfort and guidance during this time. Lord, I ask you to be with Miss Ashlyn, Lord, and her health, the things that are going on inside of her body. Lord, I believe that you are the great physician. I believe that you can put your hand on that situation and you could heal her right now. But, Lord, I know that our ways are not your ways and our thoughts are not your thoughts. I ask you, Lord, that you would do something mighty inside of her body and, Lord, that you would make yourself known in the process. Lord, I ask you to be with Miss Katie's biological mother tonight. Lord, I ask you, Father, that you would give somebody some reassurance of her. Lord, that you would let her be safe, that you would let her be okay. Lord, I ask you, God, just to put your hand on that woman. And Lord, I pray for Miss Shay's parents, Lord, her mom and dad tonight. I ask you, God, to do a mighty work in their lives. Lord, do something for them. I ask you, Jesus, to get all up in their life. Lord, I ask you to affect their everyday walk, their everyday talk, how they eat, how they sleep. Get in their lives, Lord, and I ask you, Father, to do those great things. Now, Lord, finally, I want to ask you one more time to bless us in the house of God tonight. Lord, I've come expecting to see you do something great. I've come expecting to get help from the sermon tonight. I've come expecting to see prayers answered. I've come expecting to see you do something wonderful. And, Lord, I believe with all my heart that you are the same God tonight as you were to answer all the prayers we prayed before, as you were to part the Red Sea, as you were to turn out the three Hebrew boys from that fire, as you was to shut the mouth of the lion. And Lord, I believe on this Wednesday night that this could be the night that you change somebody's life. I believe this could be the sermon somebody needs to get through the storm they're going through. I believe this could be the night that somebody needs to face that giant in their way. And I'm asking you, Jesus, to do a mighty work in the house of God tonight. Bless the man of God as he delivers the message. Use this place tonight. Father, meet with us here at Greater Life. We thank you for all that you've done and all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. most famously sang this song was a preacher by the name of Lester Roloff. Lester Roloff died in a plane crash. That's how the Lord took him out. And they said when they found his body, he was gripping on to his Bible as tight as he possibly could. And this song says, run if you want to and run if you will, but I came here to stay. If I fall down, I'm going to get back up because I didn't start out to play. It's a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. It's a fight. It's not a game. So run if you want to and run if you will, but I came here to stay. I thank God for men like that who set the way for somebody like me coming up, that I could see that there were some men, even in the most dangerous and terrifying moment of their life, they gripped on to Jesus. In a moment that the plane was, you listen to me, when a plane's going down, you've accepted full defeat. There is no coming back from that. And in that man's last moments, all he wanted to do was hold his Bible. And I can only pray that the Lord, not only for me, but for each and every one of you, this ain't about being a preacher, this ain't about being a Baptist, it's about being a child of God. I can only pray that one day the Lord gives me the type of faith and the type of strength that the preachers of old had, that the saints of old had. I don't compare my life to theirs, but I see that they had something a lot of this generation just doesn't. And I pray that God can use me that way. I pray God can use you that way. And I hope this song is a blessing. Well, the champions marched for 40 days, saying, give me a man to fight. The Israelites, well, they had a great heart, but their feet are full of fright. Then a boy with a sling and a pocket full of rocks who knew how to trust and pray said, run if you want to, run if you will, I came here to stay. Run if you want to, run if you will, I came here to stay. If I fall down, I'm gonna get back up, cause I didn't start out to play. It's a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. Fight and not a game. So run if you want to, run if you will, I came here to stay. The decree'd been signed by the hand of the king. Daniel couldn't talk to the Lord. Hungry lions were pacing their den, saying, here comes supper again. But a little while later, when the king looked in, he heard old Daniel say, if you talk about me, forget it, boys, I came here to stay.
Good to be back in the house of the Lord tonight, and I'm very thankful for this opportunity that the pastor has given me to be able to stand and preach behind his pulpit while he's away. And I don't take it very lightly because this is a sacred desk that I stand behind, and I'm just very thankful for this opportunity because without God, I would not be able to stand here today. His power and his gracious and loving kindness is why and how I can stand here and speak behind this desk and talk to y'all, because if not, I'd be a nervous wreck, as I already am. But I'm just so thankful for his power. I'm just thankful that one day he passed by my way, and I felt his power. He took me out of the wretched state that I was in and the broken state that I was in, and and turned my life a complete 180 from where I was heading to where I am now. And I'm so glad and so thankful for his power. Tonight, I want to talk a little bit about his power and some people that experienced his power. But if you don't mind, if you would turn into your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter number 13. I will be reading from verse number 4. The short little passage in there, short little scripture, and a short little insert here that I want to talk about. 2 Corinthians chapter number 13. If you're there and you love Jesus, say amen. Verse number 4 says, "For though he was crucified through weakness, yet he liveth by the power of God. For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God towards you." And verse number 4 says, "Yet he liveth by the power of God." Let's pray. God, I thank you for today, God. And God, I thank you for your power, Lord. Lord, I thank you from where you had brought me from, God, from where I was heading, God, to where I am now, Lord. And it's all because of your power, God. It's all because of your grace and your mercy. And Lord, I just thank you for the message that you have given me, Lord. And Lord, I pray tonight that it's a help through somebody, God. God, I pray that you set me aside, Lord, and preach right through me, Lord. And Lord, I pray that your spirit would be felt here tonight, God. And Lord, I just thank you for all that you're doing, God, and all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. As I was saying, yet he lived by the power of God, living in his power. A lot of us has experienced God's power. I mean, we have had a lot of great services around here recently. I mean, the Spirit, it was so real in here. It just feels great. I mean, that's just, you're feeling an ounce of his power. I mean, you're not feeling his full power, but you're feeling a small ounce of his power. Josh, where you were at before you were saved, you said you were called to preach. You said that you were doing the right thing, but one day during choir practice, a song was being sung, and you said you felt his power among you, and you got saved while being a preacher. No matter who you are, no matter the position that you hold, no matter the calling that you so-called thought that you had on your life, that you're not too big for God's power. You are not too big to feel the power of the Lord. I mean, imagine how Jonah felt whenever God told him to go preach. He told him to go to Nineveh. He sent him on his way, and Jonah said, "No, I'm not going. I'm going to run." And Jonah ended up in the belly of the whale for 3 days and three nights. And it took him being in the belly of the whale 3 days and three nights just to be spat back out, just for him to say, "I will go." Jonah felt his power whenever that whale swallowed him up. Not only Jonah, but, I mean, you see the three Hebrew boys who walked through the fire. I mean, they got thrown in the fire because they wouldn't worship King Nebuchadnezzar's golden image. And through that fire, I mean, I watched Chicago Fire, and I have seen through those shows what a fire will do to somebody. And it's horrific. Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong. I don't know how Pastor Tyler is a firefighter. Me, him, and Brandon got into it about he don't need to take that test, but he don't listen to us. But I, as a man, could not walk through a fire. No matter how tough I am, no matter how strong I am, I will not walk through a fire. But these three boys were thrown in a fire, and the heat was crunk all the way up. And they come out with not even a single burn on them. That's the power of God. It said that there was an image of a man and the shape of the man of God, or the Son of God. That's the power of God. And my question here is to you is, how are you living in his power? Are you just calling on him and needing him when something's going wrong? Are you just calling on him and asking for help whenever you can't figure something out? The reason why I want to get into living in his power and why it's so important is because day in and day out, I have to have his power to keep on going. I can't live off of Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night. I have to live through Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Amen. That's why I love traveling with Pastor Tyler and going to places with him, because it rejuvenates me. It helps me stay in my Bible. It helps me to pray, because without it, I would be just a lost cause. But there was three people that I find that in the Bible, and there was plenty of more people that I could have talked about. I could have talked about Elisha. I could have talked about Naaman. There was plenty of people that I could have talked about. But the first person I want to talk about is somebody who experienced an unexpected power. And if these points sound wrong, the Lord gave them to me over there just 2 minutes ago, so y'all get mad at him, okay? Moses experienced an unexpected power. Now, we all know the story of Moses. We know that Moses wrote the Ten Commandments. We know that Moses delivered the Israelites from Egypt and the Pharaoh. But there was one day where Moses experienced the power of God. Now, I'm going to give you a little backstory. Now, we know that the Israelites were held captive and slaves to Pharaoh and his army for 430 years. God's people enslaved for 430 years. Even after having a covenant from Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, God allowed his people to be enslaved. Now, it was for, and I believe wholeheartedly it was for this particular reason. God knows exactly what's going to happen. God knows the story already before we know it. But Moses was born, and we know that for 3 months he was hid. And we know that the decree in the land from Pharaoh was that any Hebrew boy, son, newborn son, was born, he was put to death. That was the decree in the land. And so Moses' mom seen that he was a goodly child. So she hid him for 3 months. But 3 months went by, and she couldn't hide him no more. There was a time where he got too big, the cries got too loud, and it was too many close calls for her to be able to hide him. So you know what she did? She took him and laid him in a basket by the riverside, hoping that somebody would find him, not knowing that it would be Pharaoh's daughter. When she put him in that basket, she said, probably said something along the lines of, God, please let my boy find a good home. God, please to steer him in the direction that you have intended for his life. But Pharaoh's daughter found him. And while Pharaoh's daughter was found him, Moses' sister was hiding afar off, watching all of it. And once she seen that Pharaoh's daughter had found him, she come running over saying, hey, do you need somebody, a Hebrew woman that can nurse this baby? And it ended up to where Moses' mom was able to raise her own child. But nobody knew that but Moses' mother. And so time has went on, and Moses was out one day just being curious, and he had seen an Egyptian smiting an Israelite, seeing him being beaten to death. Or just who knows why, but Moses seen it. And we know that Moses was raised up in the way that Pharaoh rose was raised up, and he had to believe the beliefs that Pharaoh believed because he was adopted by Pharaoh's daughter, but he didn't take too kindly to that, but seeing somebody being beat up just for no reason. So you know what Moses did? He killed that Egyptian. He got rid of the problem. And so he hid the body. And I know Moses was scared, and he probably didn't know what to do. But he ended up running. And why did he run? Because Pharaoh found out. And Pharaoh wanted to kill him. Pharaoh wanted to get rid of the problem just like Moses got rid of the problem. But so Moses ran, and for 40 years, Moses went into hiding. At the time, he ended up getting married. He ended up having a son. And through this, at one point in time, Moses was heading through the backside of the desert. And then I've said all this to get to this point right here. And Moses got back, went to the backside of the desert, and a bush caught on fire. As Moses was walking, a bush. And now, if I light that on fire, we all know what's going to happen. But God and all of his power came to Moses in a burning bush because God heard his people cry out at the end of that chapter in Exodus. He heard his people after Pharaoh died moaning and groaning and complaining and saying, God, why are you letting this happen to us? And he remembered the covenant that he had made with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And so Moses was leading, and in the midst of the fire, a burning bush, God spoke to Moses. In that point in time, Moses experienced the power of God. I mean, Josh, imagine walking down the street one day, and the Lord says, hey, boy, Josh, come here. And you just see a bush on fire. I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm not walking over there. I feel like that's a trap. No, but God called Moses over and said, I am God Almighty, and I want you of all people to deliver my people out of captivity. And Moses says, how? Me? I mean, why me? I was the Pharaoh's son at one point. I mean, he ran me out. And why do you want me, of all the people in the world that you could ask to do this, why me? And let me just say this. The reason God picks you is because he knows there's a purpose and a plan behind it. There's a reason behind it. And his power is going to be set amongst you as long as you follow him and trust his word and trust his command. But back to what I was saying is Moses was asking, God, why me? And so God says, Moses says, well, how am I supposed to do this? And I think it's something along the lines of God said, you see that rod in your hand? Throw it on the ground. He threw it on the ground and it turned into a serpent. And Moses took off running. And then God says, grab it. And went right back to a rod. And in that time, point in time, Moses believed that he could deliver the children of Israel from captivity. He knew at that point in time that the power of God was right in front of him. He just had to trust him and obey him. So Moses, what does Moses do? He goes and finds his brother. And he says, hey, this is what's going to happen, and I need your help. And so Moses and Aaron does what God tells them to do. And they go to Pharaoh. And he says, please let my people go. Pharaoh says, no. Why now, after 430 years, would I let your people go? Just because you asked me to. And God told Moses along the line, saying, I am that I am. And tell Pharaoh this. And he says, no. Well, we all know that there was 10 plagues. Why were there 10 plagues? Because there were 10 different times that Moses went to Pharaoh asking him to let his people go. And each time Pharaoh said no, and each time Pharaoh's heart got hardened every single time. Now, what were those 10 plagues? The first one was turning the water from the river into blood. The second one was frogs. I can't stand a frog. Amen. Three, lice, gnats. Four, swarms of flies. Five, pestilence of the livestock. All their cattle, all their donkeys, oxen, sheep, everything dead. Number six, boils on the skin. Seven, storms of hail. I heard somebody talking about hail right before service started. They had this for a while just because Pharaoh said no. Imagine hail all the time. Our cars would be beaten to death. I mean, insurance companies would not have a fun time if it hailed all the time. Number eight, locusts. Number nine, darkness for 3 days. Dark for 3 days. Back then they didn't have flashlights, so I'm carrying around a candle or whatever, lantern, whatever they can do for light just to be able to see. Number 10, death of the firstborn son. Now, this one right here is there was a cure, an answer given to protect your firstborn son. Now, Pharaoh in his hardened heart didn't listen after Moses told him, and it happened. He lost his boy. Now, at the time, Pharaoh was upset, and I can see that while he's upset, he's just ready for him to get out. He's tired of all these 10 plagues that have done happen. I mean, my God, you keep coming to my house, and every day something bad happens. Can you please just take them and go? Just get out of here. Well, that's exactly what Moses did. He took them, and Moses left. But about some point, Pharaoh said, what in the world am I doing? I just let them go for free. So you know what he did? He got ticked off. He got mad. He said, boys, let's go. We got some people to go pick up. Now, on their way, Moses realized it. And here's another, here's something else too. Is you've seen the power whenever Moses, the Lord come to Moses at the burning bush, but you also see the power whenever they got to that Red Sea. Now, remember, the rod that Moses threw on the ground that turned into a serpent was the same exact rod that he smit the ground with, and it parted the Red Sea. And as while those Israelites were walking through, running through really, and trying to get across, and the second, I'm 100% positive that the second the last one stepped over, that sea went right back in and drowned Pharaoh and his complete army. And that was the end of it. And Moses experienced it. The power was so strong in that very moment, I believe an atheist would even have believed in God at that point in time. I mean, so tell me why do you only believe in his power when it benefits you? Why, I'm going to say that again. Why does it that you only believe in his power when it benefits you? Why do we only call on him when we need help? Why don't we call on him whenever we just want to talk to somebody? I mean, he's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. I mean, he literally says, I am your father. I'm your Savior. I mean, if somebody's my Savior, I'm going to want to talk to them. I mean, I'm not just going to sit around and not want to talk to them. But why do we only do it when it benefits us? Why do we do it when it only helps us out in the long run? Not only do I see Moses, but I see the lady with an issue of blood experience an unforgettable power. Now, this short passage in Luke, chapter number 8, is when Jesus was on the way to Jairus' house, however you say his name, and to see what was wrong with his daughter. His daughter was very sick, and Jesus had made, and if you read Luke chapter number 8, I've listened to Kenny Baldwin preach a message on this about the ships earlier on in the chapter, but if you read chapter 8, I mean, there's so many miracles that happen in just that one chapter on the way to Jairus' house, just to see why his daughter's sick. But while he's on the way in Luke chapter number 8, there's a lady. She's got an issue of blood. She's got a sickness. She's got a disease. She's got a problem, and she doesn't know how to get rid of it. She's had this issue for 12 years. It said that she has been to every physician, every doctor, anybody who can do anything with medication or sickness, she has been to. And they all told her the same thing. I have no idea what's wrong with you, and I cannot help you. And I know that's discouraging because there's times in life where we get to a point where people say, I can't help you and I don't know what's wrong. But let me tell you this, the power of God can fix any problem. The power of God can fix any situation going on in your life just by living in his power. How do you live in his power? Trust him, serve him to the fullest, obey his command, listen to him, not just ask him for stuff, listen to him. Because a lot of us, the pastor says it all the time, a lot of us go and pray, and we just pray, and then we say amen, and we don't give God an opportunity to talk. That's a one-sided conversation. How would you like it, Josh, if I come up to you and said something to you and asked you a question and just walked away? It'd kind of tick you off, wouldn't it? That, or you just be like, I don't care. The lady with an issue of blood, she could not figure out what was wrong with her, and she heard that somebody was coming to town. Somebody special was walking through town, and there was a big old crowd around him. Now, I preached a message here before about the lady of an issue of blood, but the power that is foreseen in this just short little bit of scripture is very interesting. Because, I mean, I know a lot of people say it, but the string. I got a string hanging off right here. And say Josh, you had that issue of blood. And in the amongst the crowd, you just walked by me, and you touched that string that's hanging off my coat right now, and that issue of blood was gone. I mean, I know, all people would know, that I'd be jumping up and down rejoicing, about having a fit and take a lap like Brother James did the other night. I mean, I don't know about you, but the power would have been felt so real in that very moment, and that's exactly what happened. She was in the crowd fighting. She's like, I just need to get to Jesus. I just need to get to Jesus. Move, please, get out of my way. And I can see her, she's crawling. It says the hem, so I'm guessing it had to be the bottom side because there's no way she got up and close to him and grabbed a string on the front side of him. It had to be from behind, and it had to be the part that was hanging down. And as she touches it, she instantly feels that something's different. What happened to me? I mean, I don't know about the issue of blood, but maybe she had little spots on her arm of red marks from that issue of blood, and they're just gone. I mean, the power, just in a string from the Lord, a string on his garment, that's how powerful our Lord is. It says your soul is sealed until the day of redemption. There is nobody that can go in and just remove his hand off of your soul. And in this very moment, her issue was gone, but Jesus said, who touched me? I feel that virtue has left me. And I'm sure she was scared for a second, but then she realized, what do I got to be scared about? My issue of blood is gone. I have no more problems. And my problem that has burdened me for 12 years and has stopped me for so long is gone. And it's just because I touched the hem of his garment. And I'm sure in that very moment, in that very day, she took off running down the road. that Jesus told her to go in good faith. I mean, go and that her faith had made thee whole. And I'm sure she took off telling every little person that she knew about Jesus. This is what Jesus did for me. This is what Jesus did for me. I had an issue of blood for 12 years, and it's gone instantly, just like that. Because she had experienced an unforgettable power. That's a power you don't forget. I mean, Brandon, I know you. And I know that if you didn't experience the power of God, that it was exactly where you would be at tonight. I know your past, and I know where you've been at. But by God, he took you from where you were and turned you around. Now you're sitting on the second row at church, serving God with your wife and your two babies. I mean, the power of God is so real. And it's awesome just to live in it. Not just experience, but to live in it. Not only do I see Moses and then the lady with an issue of blood, but I see that a blind man experienced an undeserving power. We're not deserving of any of the power or the grace or the mercy that the Lord has shown us. I should be lost and going to a devil's hell, but God's grace and mercy was bestowed upon me, and that's why I'm here standing here today. And I'm all here because of the Lord. I wouldn't be the man I am today without God himself. But I see a blind man in John chapter number 9 who experienced an undeserving power. Now, and it says, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, Master, who did sin, this man, nor his parents, that he was born blind? And listen right here to verse number 3. Jesus answered, neither hath this man sinned, nor his parents, but the works of God should be made manifest in him. The man did nothing wrong. His parents did nothing wrong. That man was born for one purpose and one reason only, and that was for him to be blind. And one day, Jesus walked by his way, spit on the ground, pick it up, make two balls, smear them both over his eyes, and tell him, go wash in the pool of Siloam. Now, the pool of Siloam means sent. In interpretation, if you read it, it means sent. Jesus sent him there. Jesus is the reason why, as soon as he washed his face off in that, and he opened his eyes, and seen that he could see again. And Jesus did all that. And let me plug this in right here. Just because something is happening in your life doesn't mean, or something else in somebody else's life is happening to them, is just because they sinned or done something wrong. Sometimes it's God putting them through something, or sometimes God putting you through something to see how he's testing your faith. Just like in this, the reason why he was blind and born blind was so that the works of God should be made manifest in him. That was his only purpose, as what it seems in life, was to be going from blind to be able to have sight. So, like I said, there's a blind man. Jesus came to him, and the disciples asked who sinned. And Jesus spat on the ground, made clay, and put it amongst his eyes. Told him to go wash in the pool of Siloam, and the man did just that. And once he was there, and he received his sight, the man looked up, and he's looking around, and he's seeing colors for the first time. He's seeing people for the first time. And he's excited because now he doesn't have to walk, tapping, looking. And I don't know where I'm at. Hey, sir, can you tell me how to get here? Can you point me in that direction or turn my body in that direction? And the second that he wipes his eyes, the power from him just wiping his eyes, took that whatever was shielding his eyes, not being able to see. It took off the smuck that was on his eyes. And that man could see. And I could see as right now as that man is getting the goosebumps all up his body. And he's jumping around praising the Lord. I can see. I can see. And don't you always know that there's somebody there that's going to try to run you down just because you're excited about something happening? Well, there was the neighbors. The neighbors there noticed and said, how were your eyes open? Weren't you just blind 5 minutes ago? Weren't you tapping around trying to find this pool, asking me if this was the pool of Siloam 5 minutes ago? And this man said, Jesus put clay on my eyes. He told me to come here, and he told me to wash my eyes. And exactly what I did, and I received my sight. And, well, they didn't believe him. They thought the man was crazy. They thought he was already able to see, probably. They probably thought that he just went and washed his eyes off just to jump around and have some fun. I mean, who knows what they were thinking about him. But, so, they took him to the Pharisees and told him the same exact thing. And the Pharisees asked him, were you blind? Yeah. Can you see me? Yeah. I mean, how is this possible? Well, I've done told you one time. Jesus. Jesus. That name Jesus. Well, Pharisees didn't believe him either. So they found his parents, took him to his parents. Well, they asked his parents, can he see? I mean, was he not born blind? Yeah, why don't you ask him? He's of age. I don't got an answer for him. Ask him again. And that man said, Jesus. Jesus. Hey, no matter for what, stand for Jesus. As we see in this, is it didn't end up good for him because he got kicked out from where he was at. They told him to leave just because they thought that he was saying he was a god. But this man was just praising Jesus. And he got kicked out, but when Jesus heard about him being kicked out, Jesus went and found him. And Jesus said in verse number 35, Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and we had found him. He said unto him, dost thou believe on the Son of God? Now, I will say this right quick, but Jesus asked him, does he believe on the Son of God? But me thinking, I guess you got blueology, you got landology, we'll call it that, okay? But me thinking was, this man had to believe before he could even see. Because why in God's name would he get up from where he is at, in the comfortable position that he is at, where he knows he's blind, there ain't nothing that can fix him, get up with mud on his face and walk to a pool if he did not believe that something was going to happen? Why would he even get up? Because he had a faith. He had a faith that something was going to happen. That's what carried him to that pool. He had a belief that he didn't know. For all he knew is he went and wiped his clay off his face and he would have been still blind for all he knew. But he had a belief that something was going to happen. But whenever Jesus saw him, he says, dost thou believe on the Son of God? And he said, who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him? And Jesus said unto him, thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. And he said, Lord, I believe, and worshipped him. And Jesus said, for judgment I come into this world, that they which not see not might see, and that they which see might be made blind. And some of the Pharisees which were with him heard these words and said unto him, are we blind also? And Jesus said unto them, if ye were blind, ye should have no sin. But now ye say, we see, therefore your sin remaineth. Jesus says right here, if you were blind, then you would see no sin. You would have no sin. But you're telling me that, asking me that, are we blind? But you see. You see who's standing in front of you. You see the Son of God standing right here in front of you. And you're still questioning the power that's right here standing in front of you. And says, but now ye say, we see, therefore your sin remaineth. I'm thankful for an unexpected faith. Unexpected power. And I'm thankful for an unforgettable power, because I will never forget the day that the Lord passed by my way. I was sitting down there and Wednesday night, and when Jay was still the youth pastor, and he was preaching God only knows what. And I just felt something just slide up beside me and say, you're lost. And I fought. No. I've already been saved. I remember the day that I was. And that was just, it's just because you said your dad got saved that day, supposedly, so you wanted to get saved. Well, like I said, I don't know what he was preaching. Heck, he could have been teaching to us about the tabernacle at one point, and I could have went down there and got saved. I don't know. But that day, I remember, in June or July, it was 23rd. It was a Wednesday night in 2019, and I got saved, and I gave my heart to the Lord, and I felt the power that I had never felt before. I felt like a new man. It's something that I've never felt before. Miss Rhonda, you couldn't come to church day in and day out and worship and still give praise to God without the power that you feel. I mean, you're such an inspiration to all of us. And I'm just so thankful for the power that God gives us, an unexpected and unforgettable and an undeserving power. We're non-deserving of anything. Everything that we have given is because God is so gracious to give it to us. And I'm just so thankful for it. And I'm going to pray, and that's going to be it. But I just want to leave that living in the power is the best thing that's ever happened to me. And if you've never experienced it, it's something that I get on board to. Is if you're lost and you don't know who Jesus is, I'd love to talk to you and pray with you about it. And, the power of God is so real and so sweet. It's something that I just cannot get over. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day, God. And God, I just pray for tonight, God, that the message here tonight was a help to somebody. God, I thank you for allowing it to be a help to me, Lord, and to be an eye-opener to your power, Lord, and the things that you have done, God. And, Lord, I just thank you for all that you're doing, Lord. And, Lord, I pray that you bless everyone that was here tonight, God. I pray that you keep our pastors safe as they're on vacation. And, Lord, I just pray that you bring them back safely, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Can we give him a hand tonight? Amen. I sure am grateful for the power of God, ain't you? Amen. It was by his power that I came to know him. It was by his power you came to know him. Amen. Praise him for the power tonight. Amen. Just a couple quick reminders and we'll be gone. Don't forget to continue to pray for Pastor and Pastor Tyler and their families as they're gone. Preschool graduation, May 23rd. That's at 6 p.m. next Thursday. Sunday the 26th, Remembrance Sunday. We're going to be honoring the fallen soldiers that day. Invite somebody to come with you in Awana graduation May 29th. Don't forget about those important dates. We'll continue to announce them as time goes on and as we get closer as well. Brother Ryan's going to be at the side door with an offering plate. He'll be taking up the offering right here tonight, and that'll be it. Don't forget church Sunday morning, 9 a.m. prayer, 9:30 Sunday school, 10 o'clock Sunday morning worship, 5 p.m. Sunday night worship. 11 o'clock Sunday morning worship. Yeah, I don't know what I said. 9:30 prayer, 10 o'clock Sunday school, 11 o'clock. Yeah, there you go. If y'all are late, it ain't my fault. I recounted all that, all right? And 9:30 prayer, 10 o'clock Sunday school, 11 o'clock Sunday morning worship, and 5 p.m. Sunday night worship. Everything is running just as normal, so we're looking forward to God being with us then and you being with us as well. Let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Dear Lord, we thank you for this night. God, we thank you for this opportunity to be in your house. Lord, we thank you for the sermon preached tonight. Lord, we thank you for your power. Lord God, we thank you that one of these days, because of your power, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You are a mighty God. You are a great God. You are a good God. And I ask you, Father, to be with each and every one of us as we journey into the rest of this week. Bring us back here Sunday, prepped and ready to praise and worship you. We thank you for all that you've done and all that you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You're at church. You're at liberty.